how did this pairing happen? Do you guys know each other from before this, or is this just a...
No, you know, I'd taken on a casting director, Lisa Roth. She's really amazing. And you guys are friends, right? Now you've known each other a little bit?
Yeah. We kind of aren't really friendly anymore, but we were at that time. Mm-hmm. But...
Awkward.
No, we were. It's not that I'm not friends with her, but But anyway, she was my friend at the time, and I was going into another audition, mm-hmm. and she's like, why don't you come into this? And then I read for, I guess, a smaller role.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we'd gone through, I can't remember if it was 3 or 4 days of auditions. Mm-hmm. You know, Sonja came in for the last day, last audition. And, you know, for a smaller role in the film, mm-hmm. And, you know, was reading with, you know, a couple of the people helping me out. And they were just dropping lines and switching parts. We had to keep stopping, you know, and it was sort of amazing. And, you know, it was great. I mean, the reason they were, you know, dropping lines, they couldn't pay attention. Sonja, you know, the electricity was just, you know, it was right there. Oh. And, you know, we kept getting confused. Sonja steps out for a minute, and I'm like, yeah, we have to give her a couple more pages. Like, she has to come in for the lead, you know.
It was so not planned, though. Like, I wasn't supposed to go on that audition. I wasn't supposed to go read for even that smaller role. I love how it all just came together, because it wasn't even, you know, that's kind of like the fate of it.
Yeah, you know, absolutely. I guess. You know, and then, you know, I gave Sonja the script that night. You know, she came in, we talked about it for like 15 or 20 minutes, mm-hmm. put her together with Brian, who, you know, plays Henry. Mm-hmm. And it was just like, okay, we have the movie.
So what was the evolution for you from the beginning? What was the thing that kind of inspired you to write this, to work on the script and to...
Yeah, there was a few events that all kind of happened at the same time. Mm-hmm. You know, principally, you know, my wife is also the editor. She was working, you know, several years ago, teaching a high school film class, mm-hmm. and, you know, for like 9th and 10th graders, and one of her favorite students came in, was really broken up, eventually broke down, you know, and revealed to her that her father had discovered some risque photos that she'd posted on MySpace. Mm-hmm. And of course she was really broken up about how strong his reaction was, how angry he was. And she knew enough that she had kept it from her parents, but didn't really understand why it was a big deal. All her friends were doing it. And there was a couple other incidences like that in different age ranges right around mm-hmm. that time for me. And I started thinking about, you know, 15 years ago, it would have been something that never would have occurred to a high school student to do something like that. And if it had, we would have thought, you know, this person is in trouble, right? Mm-hmm. And now with like, every, you know, Facebook, MySpace, Instagram, et cetera, we're all documenting ourselves all the time. And, you know, the mediation of who we're putting out as us into the world, and that's becoming part of flirtation. So that was kind of the genesis for me.
Part of your universe, Sonja, is that?
Yeah, and who you think you're portraying yourself to be, or who you think you want to see yourself to be, or who you think you, how people see you, you mm-hmm. know? Like how, you know, all these like layers of just unknowing bullshit that I kind of, you know, I personally did have and have sometimes in my life, you know, that just, it's sometimes I'm so unaware of it, you know, and.
Well, I mean, I think that's the thing, like everybody, I mean, you know, we were talking about it before Sonja and I, it's basically, you know, you know, I'm cognizant of this thing that's going on, mm-hmm. and it doesn't stop me from doing it, you know?
Right,
from like,
right.
I'm taking the picture that I'm happy at the party and Instagram, even though I'm not having a great time.
Right.
Right? Like, I'm putting myself out there in a way that's not really me, you know? So I think that that's something that's like, even if you're aware of it, it's so ever-present that mm-hmm. it just becomes something you're doing.
Yeah.
And of course, with this film, it was about finding people who, you know, it was about the characters actually having that kind of disconnect where they felt like they needed to do that in order to figure out who they were.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And did you know what kind of, how you wanted to make the film? What the feeling of the production would be? And
yeah, I mean, you know, the script was written to a target in terms of, I knew about what we had available to us, mm-hmm. you know, in terms of locations and this and that. You know, I'd been collecting all of these things for the film, you know, for a couple of years at that point. And so I knew it was very targeted in those terms. And as far as the aesthetic of the film, you know, it was both wanting to kind of channel a lot of these, you know, like the kind of SoCal noir, mm-hmm. but at the same time also establishing an environment where the performance is king, you know, where we're going to set everything up and it's just about finding the most room to have comfort for, you know, myself and the actors to work to kind of build, you know, the thing that mattered to me, which was like, you know, it wasn't so much about anything other than just getting the best performances and for the film.
So you have a box to work in and you want to find
right.
great actors
right.
that can
absolutely.
Play.
Build the box and then completely fill it to the brim. You know?
Yeah, build the box. Yeah, like, yeah, exactly. I remember the homework you gave me once was just to think about, you know, Charlie, my character, and, you know, and just how interesting that is. To just create a character, you know, a person, a me, mm-hmm. a new me, and the depth of that, and how cool, it's just so fun. I think it's just so fun, you know, and the freedom to do what my will was with that, you know, it was really cool.
Yeah.
That's what I loved about working with you.
Yeah, I mean, well, thank you. I mean, that was the goal, was to create an environment where we all knew the characters really well, and mm-hmm. therefore we knew the beats of the scenes, and everybody could kind of, you know, fill in what they wanted at that moment. And
right.
the way that, and then knowing that how we were building the film from an editorial standpoint was going to allow for lots of pieces of great takes, even though the repeated moments, and so that we would be able to use all of the stuff that we had created as, you know, instead of just either or, we could have everything.
Mm-hmm. So how many takes would you do in a sequence?
You know, we wouldn't really do more than two takes per camera angle, mm-hmm. but we used a lot of camera angles to build through.
I mean, you were
scenes.
Shooting multiple cameras, or that you were?
No,
just...
we were shooting just one camera, but the way that we moved through the scene was, you know, lots of different ways of shooting. Because there's this theme of repetition and rehearsal and rewriting the experience, it allowed for us to do very divergent takes, find new things that we liked halfway through a scene, mm-hmm. and then start building on those. I don't know, how do you feel about it?
What necessarily?
In terms of like, you know, was it like too many, I can't even, if you remember, like in
yeah.
terms of the numbers of takes we did, or like.
I don't really necessarily remember
yeah.
that as being like, I guess I don't remember it being so many takes, so I guess it wasn't like that, but I the one thing I do remember is the way you treated me and us and the freedom you gave me and how I felt comfortable. That's really what stayed with me yeah. about that experience.
Were the other cameras like coverage, or was it really like they didn't quite match? They were
no. I mean,
were
it's
matching.
It's a. I mean, the film is very. I mean, in the way that you know, I wrote the script was intentionally for jump cut editing, mm-hmm. right? And that allowed for all kinds of different things in terms of like breaking lines and moving around the room, and you know, a lot of the you know, shots would start off, you know, just follow Sonja around, you know, like we want to keep this kind of frame and then just move around to what's interesting, right? Mm-hmm. And so from take to take, that might be totally different things. So even though it's supposed to be the same camera angle, it might end up not being at all. I mean, if that makes sense.
So when you saw the movie, Sonja, did you have any idea what you were going to see?
I just heard... I saw it today for the first time, and I heard so many amazing reviews already, and I was just like really anxious to see it, and I was really pleasantly, you know, not surprised because everyone's telling me how great it is, but I really liked it. I didn't realize how funny it was and how incredibly weird Brian is.
Right, right.
And just, yeah, the moments. I totally forgot about all those moments.
Yeah.
Are you invested in watching yourself when you see a movie like this? I mean, are you able to disconnect from...
It's good to see, because I want to see how I look like and what I could do better, you know, and what mm-hmm. I need help with, which is probably a lot. And I think it's always good to see, because I used to not that I've been doing it a long time, but I used mm-hmm. to like not want to see myself because like, but then I realized like, that's not how I'm going to learn, you know, because I need to really see myself. So I was so happy. I was so happy.
Glad to hear it.
Are there such things as dailies on your movie, or do you guys look at footage and go, okay, well this is what's working. This is not.
No.
Yeah. The way we set it up was really just to try to be in the moment and feel like we had it at the time, mm-hmm. you know? And I mean, I remember like, you know, your first day, you know, the scene with you and Nina where you come over to her place. Mm-hmm. I mean, we did a master, you know, and neither of us were really happy with it for different reasons. Mm-hmm. You know, like you weren't happy that you were wearing sunglasses because it was like, you were like, this doesn't look right.
Right.
Like, and I was like, yeah, it's something weird about this. And then we just didn't really talk much about it. And it's just like, okay, let's just go, mm-hmm. right? And then, you know, when Sonja came in again, like everything changed. Like basically the blocking went out the window, like different beats all of a sudden started happening with, you know, with Nina and Sonja kind of playing with the moments, you know, in the script. We took that master through the whole scene, which we hadn't planned on doing, mm-hmm. and then we finished. Yeah. It was like, that's it. That's how we're doing. That's what we're doing. That's the scene.
Yeah. Oh, right.
You know.
Yeah, yeah. That was cool.
It sounds like an accident you planned for, though.
Yeah.
Like that was what you wanted.
Prepare.
Ultimately.
I mean, that's the thing. We spent a long time preparing to be ready to capture a lot of things that we hoped we would get, but you don't. I mean, with the short amount of time. And with the emphasis, you know, being on the performance, it's basically, let's keep it real as fresh as we can mm-hmm. for as long
without
as we can.
Without over preparing.
Right. Yeah.
So why acting?
Good question. I don't know. I know why now, but I haven't been doing it for that long, but I think recently I've started to really like it because of... I've been doing this acting class with a teacher I really like, mm-hmm. and I sort of fell in love with it. And been doing movies like with JR and some other films that I really liked.
Did performance always appeal to you, or were you
no.
pushing away from that as a kid?
I was pushing away. And I was more into on the other side, like drawing and filming and photographing, painting, all that stuff.
So very creative, but not
Yes,
this.
Always creative.
And then the acting class just kind of put it all together for
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I was in a movie with this actress, Karen Austin, and she really helped me a lot in this mm-hmm. film. And like, she's like, if you just use your voice, you know, it just comes and all these, and I learned if I use my voice, I just, all this fucking emotion comes, mm-hmm. you know? And how strong that is. And I felt, that was like an awakening for me because it just felt amazing, and I started taking her class, and I really fell in love with it.
Mm. And do you feel pressure being a Kinski? Is that an issue at all for you, or are you just kind of over that?
No. My mom, she's supportive either way, whatever I do.
No, it's just that there's a lot of expectations because, you know, you come from a great family.
Right.
And it's an interesting situation to be in as a young actor.
Very interesting. Considering that there's a lot of different issues
but,
around
you know,
that.
But
you know?
Sonja's up to the challenge. I mean, that's the
but
thing.
I mean, I love my mom, and I know she's awesome, and I know her dad was really famous, and I was a big fan until I learned that he wasn't very good to her. Mm-hmm. But I'm very appreciative of Herzog and his work, and I'm a big fan of his. It's cool to come from that. I feel very blessed.
So your attitude towards work is just to find stuff where you can go do the work that you want to do, that you're trying to figure out at this point?
What do you mean?
Well, like this particular project, which is, it's not just like, okay, I read the script and I auditioned and, you know, go made a movie.
Yeah, I guess I'm just kind of rolling with it. Mm-hmm. And I'm just going where it feels good right now. And
so working like this felt pretty great.
Yeah,
like.
It felt pretty amazing. Yeah, yeah.
So what were your expectations when you now you've had the film shot?
Right.
Eventually you're going to get it in the can. Were you thinking, okay, now let's go to the film festivals. Let's go to this. Go to that.
You
or what?
No, it doesn't. You know.
I had no idea it was going to be like this. Like I didn't. I really
not
didn't.
At all.
I don't know why. I just didn't.
The whole time. My focus is make the best film we can make.
Right, you know, but I remember how focused you were.
It's not about, I mean, you know, I'm an unknown. It's not about like dreaming of some kind of potential thing. It's about focusing on the work, preparing for the work, doing the best job we can, and hopefully, you know, if anything else happens, if the film, hopefully the film finds a life of its own, you know, that we can enjoy. But past that, it was just how can we make the best film we can, given our resources, given the box we built, how good can we make it? That's it.
Yeah. So as a filmmaker, you just go on regardless of what happens here and say, okay, I want to make, this is a form that I want to work in?
Or? I have to. If I think about, you know, if I think about everyone else, and I mean, obviously, you know, I mean, my favorite author, Nabokov, he had like a really, for me, it's a totally inspiring moment when he was asked, you know, why does he write? And he says, well, I write so that one other person can recognize something that they already knew and just hadn't figured out how to say it yet. And for me, it's hard work to do that, but if you can focus on, if I can just communicate to one other person, then what I did was worth doing, and I'll try to do it again.
You know? And film is your first love or your...
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I always wanted to make film. I mean, I knew. I come from a writing background primarily, but it was always, you know, how to find literary forms in narrative filmmaking, and yeah.
So today was your first screening?
Yeah, premiere.
First time a public group saw it, I guess?
Yeah.
You probably didn't have test screenings, I'm guessing.
No, there was no test. No.
Probably test screening across the budget of your film.
Right, like exactly. Yeah, four friends of mine. Yeah, it's a good test. Hey,
so
guys,
a little bit nervous going into it, or
incredibly nervous? Yeah, of course. Yeah, I mean, it's a big thing to put yourself out, and especially when you have people counting on you.
Yeah. I mean, we're all counting on each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're in it together.
We can be nervous together.
Yeah.
So how was it for you?
Oh, it was great. It was great. It was amazing. You know, it's a wonderful experience. I mean, Slamdance has been incredibly generous to us, incredibly generous to me personally. You know, I knew how to build this box, and I didn't know anything about what to do after I did that, and we're very fortunate to find that home, and have them help us find an audience. It's been incredible.
With a comedy, you can always kind of tell you're either getting laughs or you're not getting laughs. In a film like this, are there landmarks that you know that you have in your head that you're going, I can tell when I have the audience in the palm of my hand?
Well, I would never say that I would have audience in the palm of my hand. That'd be get back to me in 10 years maybe. But I feel like midway through the film, I felt like it was working in the premiere because I could feel that people were reacting to the things that I was hoping for.
I know, it was crazy, right?
Yeah.
I didn't remember being funny like that.
Yeah.
But I guess that's how it...
Well, it is, but that's the thing. I mean, it's a dark film in some ways, but in order for it to have moments of darkness, it has to have moments where you can relax and enjoy.
And it couldn't have been funny to me at that moment, otherwise it wouldn't have been funny.
Yeah, also true. Also true. Yeah, well, it's funny, everyone read the script, and half the people thought, I'm making a movie about horrible people, and the other half thought, so this is really funny. <You know>? And I was like, yeah, well, let's just try to meet in the middle, and we'll be okay.
Right.
You know.
So do you have a sense of what you would like people to walk away from the movie with, or is it just that you want them to take the ride?
Yeah, I mean, I try not to impose.
Impose a little. Is there something you would like people to...
Yeah, I mean, I'd like people to think about, I would like people to come away thinking about how they interact with the world in the sense of how they're putting themselves out there, and also be more generous to particularly younger people who put themselves out in a way that they don't fully understand. You know, I mean, I think that's kind of one thing that I would say. I don't know how you feel.
I want to agree with that, and also maybe to just to see that it's normal to just like want to check out sometimes, you know, in whatever quarter or camera or you know filming whatever the you know. Mm-hmm. I think that's normal, and that's just a way of a lot of people checking out, but at the same time, I think we all do it. I mean, I do it. And it's a healthy way of doing it, I guess, because it's an art. But and it's just bringing up a subject of what is present and what is, I don't know, it brings up a lot of oneself, I think, mm-hmm. and questions about oneself. And just, I think it's good to always ask questions about yourself.
And how to find yourself. I mean, particularly, I mean, you know, in this film, it's, you know, it's not just, you know, it's somebody in their mid-30s, it's somebody in their mid-20s, but it's true over and over again. And I feel like, you know, just because you think you know something doesn't mean you know it. There might be a better way to, or more ways to get to the bottom of it.
Well, I guess you wonder over time with the electronics these days, whether or not kind of all these things being somewhat public or accessible in a different way, whether that's good or bad, or whether the kid who, you know, the 25-year-old who was crying in their apartment with nobody knowing was better off or worse
off
for having had that privacy.
And it's, you know, it's complicated. You know, I think, I mean, that's the thing. It's a part of our culture now. And, you know, there are ramifications that we don't see yet. We can see some of them. And, you know, to me, part of the other thing that, you know, I think is important to think about in terms of what people come away from the film is that it's accelerating, you know, that it's not reaching a plateau. It's more and more and more and more. And how do we deal with these things?
Mm. You know? And adults are stuck dealing with it too.
Absolutely.
Old people even.
Everyone.
Well, it used to be old people. It's all changing every few minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And are you ready for more festivals? Is that what you expect the next 6 months to be?
Yeah, I mean, I hope so.
On the road and...
Well, if we're lucky, yeah. I mean, I would hope that would be wonderful. That would be wonderful.
So
and then working on another film. Those are the two, you know, that's, we'll see.
So will it take you 2 years to build the box again, or the new box?
I don't know. The new box? I've been working on this new box for a while. So 2 years, but it didn't just start. How about that?
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you, Sonja, want to keep doing kind of indie films and films that are challenging this way?
I'm working on one right now. I love it, yeah. I love it.
Do you want to go blow stuff up in, you know, a big sci-fi movie for a studio or something also? Or is that not even interesting to you?
I don't think that would be... Yeah, of course. Same. All of it.
So it's all kind of territory that's interesting and
fresh.
Yeah,
I think, because I'm. It's new for me, you know, and I want to experience all I can.
Do you feel like you know more about it going in than because your mom than you would have otherwise, or are you kind of?
Definitely, I think, because my mom has that experience, and I can go to her for questions, and she gives me a lot of advice, stuff like that.
But you're still gathering the sense of the world that you're working in now.
Oh yeah, well yeah.
You don't feel like an old veteran.
Oh no.
At this point.
Oh no, not at all.
It's fresh.
I'm new. I mean, I'm new, you know.
And is it fun the way, is the outcome of the film, is seeing a completed film,
is it
as exciting, or is it really the work you did on the set those days that got you excited?
I think it's the set those days. I think that's really why I do this, but the outcome of the film is really exciting too, because I've never been to Sundance, and this is what I mean, all these like mechanics I don't know a lot about, so it's really cool to see it and what happens and what, you know, how it all goes about happening, you know. I was saying it's interesting for me maybe as an off job to work as a PA maybe on set, because it's good for me to know, you know, what clothes, the whatever mean, you know what I mean, like with the martini, like sometimes I don't know what they mean, and I see, you know, all these PAs working and they want to be actors and film directors and all these things, and I understand why, because you learn a lot. Mm-hmm. And I think it's good to be around any sort of thing like that.
So can Sonja PA on your next film?
Yeah, can I PA for your next film?
She do everything. She may have PA'd already a little bit.
Really?
On the last film. I remember there was some, you know, help my mom some washing dishes after
our
lunch.
Oh, that doesn't count.
Oh, okay.
So your craft services were my mom?
Yeah, my parents came
She's
out.
Amazing.
Yeah.
She's a really gourmet chef. Huh.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of one of my aces in the hole is that I can call on my mom, who was trained by Julia Child, and she can bring it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's a nice, everybody gets a chuckle, and then we had the first day, and they're like, this is lunch?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I don't have a lot, but we've got this.
You've got the greatest craft services in any independent film ever.
The best craft services around.
That's true.
And you've got a wife who cuts.
That's right.
So that's a beautiful thing.
I've got the support of the family, so.
And do you guys spend a lot of time cutting, or is this a fairly short
window? No, it was a long time. But it was, you know, it was a long time because we have day jobs, so. You know, we'd cut once a week. We had our one day a week where, you know, we're gonna attack it. And I think it worked really well for this film. You know, we didn't, because it allowed us to never really overwork it, mm-hmm. And it kept it really fresh, and it kept us wanting to come back over. You know, it's like, I wish we could take some days off and just cut. You know, and so that impulse, you know, stayed with us the entire time, so it was really good.
And dare I ask what the day job is? Roughly?
Roughly? I'm a workflow engineer and post-production supervisor by day. So I do a lot of stuff in terms of catching what comes out of the back of cameras and then helping it get back onto screens.
But this is your universe?
Yeah.
In some level. I mean, you're part of the family. You're not like coming in as a... You know, you weren't a high school teacher who decided to make a movie.
No, yeah. I mean, I do that. I mean, I do teach. I teach it at California Institute of Arts in the film directing program.
Yeah. There.
But yeah, no. I mean, for me, you know, as Sonja said, you know, it's just a matter of, like, you keep learning. You know, I put myself through undergrad as a network administrator. I showed up in grad school and said, I bet you don't have any net admins, you know, that want to work for you part-time. You know, they threw me into the labs and... when I came out, I got a job in the industry doing, you know, working. I was originally supposed to just be working on indie films, and then very quickly, I lucked out with some really large digital productions that allowed me to learn a lot of stuff really fast and put all that to use on this film and the other films that I've worked on, you know, where it's, you know, how do we simulate the result and without being able to have the same process, you know.
So for you, digital was really critical to this film getting
Absolutely.
Made. This is one of those good stories.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's what, you know, I mean, we know we're gonna shoot with practical lighting, and it's just gonna be about controlling that practical lighting because we know we wanna spend 10 hours a day with the performance. We don't wanna spend 3 hours a day with the performance. And, you know, really the way that I know how to do that is digitally. That's another thing.
So it helped to have somebody who looks like Sonja. So you don't have to spend a lot of time trying to make her look pretty.
You get beautiful people and that give you great performances. The rest of the stuff, it figures itself out.
Is she always this shy or just when you talk about her being pretty?
I'm always this shy.
Yeah.
No.
Depends. Not this shy when you're performing.
Yeah.
When you're performing, you go for it.
When I'm
100%.
When I'm not sleeping that much, I'm shy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You came straight from set, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Straight from set to the plane.
I didn't sleep.
Yeah. To Park City.
I'm not good on not sleeping, but I'm running on adrenaline, and this is awesome. So I'm very happy to be here.
Yeah.